Blackstone presents Vain Pursuits by Rhett C. Bruno and Jaime Castle. This book is read by Roger Clark. And throwing down the pieces of silver into the temple, he departed. And he went and hanged himself. Matthew chapter 27, verse 5. 1. Throughout my life, the sound of gunfire has always been an omen of bad, bad things. Whether I'm at the wrong end of it or the right, someone's blood has wetted the earth. Someone's heart's gonna stop. A paltry sacrifice to the god of death, if there is such a thing. Hell, it's the last thing I heard in my natural life. That final blast from Ace Riker's Lamette sending me hurtling into this unlife where I have the unspeakable honor of serving as a hand of God, a black badge, beholden to the whims and caprices of angels in perpetuity, all to circumvent eternity in the icy torments of hell. Gunshots. As common in the West as the caw of a hungry crow. As common as dying of thirst and hunger. As common as impropriety amongst men of ill repute. Bang! The revolver next to me went off, lead grazing rock down a ways. A handful of stones were lined up on a cracked and dried out tree stump. The remaining portion of the spindly trunk had long fallen over into the marshlands. "Woo-wee, almost got it," I said. The widow, Rosa, glanced at me sidelong, those green eyes glistening like a field of fresh grass amid the arid desert sands. However, a threat was there, dancing behind them, a viridescent sky before a tornado. Then, too, there was weariness. Neither of us had found much sleep, though for different reasons. Hers, likely nightmares about the wicked man, the necromancer who took the life of her dear husband, with power she couldn't understand and I couldn't divulge the truth behind. Or maybe it was the more recent memory of Ace Riker in Revelation Springs, another evil son of a bitch responsible for such heinous acts of horror, they were better off buried hell deep. Luck didn't seem to follow Rosa, unless you counted me. For my part, the lack of sleep derived from a sort of emptiness, a great chasm of nothing that existed behind my undead eyelids. My body couldn't feel. So sleep was a remedy for nothing but a spent mind aching for a moment's respite. Never true restfulness, not anymore. And so, with Rosa waking with a startle and me already having been up, staring out at the fog of the southern wetlands, here we found ourselves playing target practice, not wanting to discuss the things eating us up inside.
Merda! I was close. Rosa said.
Her voice was like velvet soaked in honey, hardly an accent at all, though she wasn't from the States. She'd worked hard for that, to fit into a place where fitting in kept you alive and free. Her raven black hair was sleek and straight, shining like bubbling oil. Olive skin appeared smooth from afar, but up close, lines formed at the corners of her eyes. Her forehead and cheeks, just a bit of roughness. Not in a bad way, mind you. Rosa was stunningly beautiful. The girl could twist a man 100 ways with nothing but a glance. The kind of lady who bewitched the senses. And trust me, as a hunter of demons and all things otherworldly, I know a thing or two about being bewitched. She'd taken to wearing all black these days, and I like to think I had some responsibility in that decision. Her sleeves bunched up at the elbows, Gold bracelets jangled on her wrists as she checked the chamber of her Colt 5 shooter, twisting her forearm to reveal a tattoo of a serpent slithering around a dagger. I'd known her back when she used to wear dresses like a proper lady. That ink always covered up as best she could. I think these traveler's clothes suited her better. My horse, Temperina.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.